to Singapore. Thank you very much for your visit. Okay, well, let me go through this line. Any questions, just stop me. Okay? We'll be very simple overview. I'm not going to give you the details of all you present. If you want to know more about us, you know what to do, right? Go to the website.
So, yeah.
Okay, you understand how Singapore's education system works, right? I don't think you do. Very quickly, we do 6 years of primary school. We start at the age of 7. Okay, so probably this is this primary school living in, like you have. You have, right? But you start earlier at the age of 6.
Yes.
Or 5.
6.
So you have that as well. Then we go to, but now in Singapore, what has happened is we have a variety of post-primary school opportunities now. The government has given the students here a lot more choices than before. Mm-hmm. During my time, of just straight after primary, secondary, and that's it, whether you do or die, you die. And many times, because many of them are not ready for academic studies.
Oh.
But now, there's a lot of variety, but it depends on the person, the student. So there's no excuse for anyone not succeeding here in Singapore. The usual route is most 80 to 85% of students who do the PSLE will come to a secondary school, go to a secondary school, do a 4-year studies, and then finish in the GCE O levels. We still do the Cambridge O level.
Oh.
Singapore still goes and gets it endorsed by the University of Cambridge. Why we don't really have our own system like you have? Because of international regulation.
Yeah.
With the whole level, you can go the whole world, basically, like I said. This. Okay, well, like I said. Okay. That's why we have government and insisted on still having the link to the University Cambridge because of regulation. But most of the papers are actually set here. We set it. We mark it by endorsed by the University of Cambridge. Most students come through here, but the very good students, the 10%, go through this what we call integrated program, meaning they don't do O levels. They do 6 years straight through in the school, then they go do the A level, right? A level here. They do the GC, your STPM. Again, Cambridge. They still go to Cambridge for the endorsements. They go straight through without sitting for the O level. The government did this a few years, 10 years ago, 12 years ago, so that they will be less exam oriented, they can do things like what you're doing now. More extracurricular around the don't have to focus on what they're doing. So the top 10% students do that. You do very well here. And then some students may want to do vocational, they may do the what we call end level exam, more hands on, technical, and then they end up in IED, the Institute of Technical Education. Some students in arts and sports can go to the sports school or arts school here. And then they still can do the O level or not, they do IB, International Baccalaureate, becoming popular, more recent phenomenon. So this is the way things can happen after you've done your
PSLE,
primary school living exam. See the variety, sports, arts, and so on. So after the O level, what happens? Remember, the majority do O level. 45% people here go to one of the polytechnics. There are 5 polytechnics in Singapore, we are the oldest. Okay. So most of them will choose this route, most after O level. About 20% will target and go to the junior college, like all of you have done, I'm sure, A levels. Right? You go to a college to do the A level exam, you go to the university. Okay. So about 20% will go here. 45% come here. And a few 10% will still go to the ITE. You lower than the polytechnic. You get the certificates in skills.
Since this is secondary school, the level itself, at such a young age, you provide options to the children.
Yeah.
They can simply choose, they can opt out any kind of a thing that fit their passions. Now, the question is, so many diversions at such an early stage for the children, what about the breakdown, the composition of each diversion that you have? Like, do you try to make it proportional to each other? Or do you see that certain level of education that being flooded with the students, how do you think about
it? If you want to do, say, the polytechnic, say, business, you better score better. If by competition, you may want to do something, but if you don't have the grade, you don't get it. So at here, they give a 12 choices. 12. they are ranked according to the wish. But the wish may not come true if you don't have the grades.
Yeah.
It's purely by merit. For the computer will come. But now we are beginning to look at talent. A big percentage, right, about 12 to 15%, we are setting aside for students who may not meet the grades. But they will have the minimum, of course, but may not get the competitive grade. But if you look at what they have done in the school, leadership, sports,
skills,
whatever, IT, for example, IT program, the guy was an IT club. Doing programming, they proved to us, to the lecturers here, at the interview, I want to have you. We have a diploma of music here. The guy may have a grade 8 piano, or grade 8 saxophone. Audition, come in. We have a diploma of nautical studies, ship. You look at his attitude, his physical fitness, eyesight. If he passed all that, can prove to the interview that our lecturers here, trained seafarers, we train seafarers here, captains of ships, can come in. So it depends on the course. We are becoming more, less dependent on grade, more on the talent. But the grade is still the basic. You don't have the grade. You got to repeat. Or maybe go to IT, or do a part-time group, evening. We do evening, a lot of evening courses at night here. At night, very busy. So the poly, the IT students also, after they've done the search, can come to us. So it's not the end of the life. They have ladders built everywhere. Even the poly, right? Our aim is to prepare our students for work. That's our aim. Like you, like university, you finish. The polytechnic aim is to prepare for the workforce. Prepare the workforce. Because nearly half of them come to us, 50% nearly. But what happens? Many of them end up furthering their studies at university. Locally, it's very competitive because you compete with the A-level guys. And then the grades are only about 25 to 30% of our students get into the local unit. The rest do a few things. They go to Australia, UK, Canada, a bit into the USA. And then they may even study in a commercial school here at RMIT, University of Nottingham, the schools here, and so on. So they do that. So this is the situation. But the aim, you hope, we, our preference is for them to work first, after work or during work, study and get a degree. So the degree will be relevant, up to date, it is employable. There are many graduates coming up, may not be able to find a suitable job. That is the worry right across the world now. Korea has the worst problems. Because they told me 2 weeks ago I posted at Korean University Academics. They have a misfit. They come up with no jobs. Because they're too academic, not ready for the work, job market. No technical skills. The poly students, advantage is they are very strong in technical skills. Our employment rate is very high. The question whether you want a job. Some are quite sticky, choosy. Here is not a problem because we are. But therefore, this plus a degree is very, very powerful combination. A lot of employers like the poly student, but topped up with a degree later. They do a 2-year top up. And some universities even offer a 1-year top up. Some do. UK universities. With a 3-year here, 1 year there, you have a degree holder. Which is sometimes, it depends on the discipline. Our mission, the polytechnic mission. Educate and train to work ready. Remember I told you, train to work. Life ready so they can keep on learning. Lifelong learning and character building and world ready. Because Singapore is so tiny, right? We're a lot smaller than you now. Already Malaysia is not very big, but we are really tiny. We need to be world ready. Just like you guys are doing this tour, right? To be world ready, basically. And our vision, to create a caring community of inspired learners who serve to mastery. This is the vision. You know the difference, right? Vision is we do now.
Yes.
Vision is we hope to do. Mm. Hoping, they're striving to that Mount Everest, the peak. That's what our principal said, I'm climbing the mountain. We are still climbing, very tiring. Caring community, we want our students to have a heart. Not only just students, staff here as well. So we do a lot of community work. Or then overseas as well, and locally. A lot of students go overseas later after you. Inspired learners, we don't want them to learn by rote, learn by, from lecturer. We want them to learn themselves. Take research, rather than waiting for the lecturer develop what to do. That's our mission. This is the way you've got to be in time to come. Change is constant, right? And you've got to learn to keep on with the change. And we hope they will serve, maybe have the humility, you know, not to be arrogant. Nah. That's how we use the word serve, with mastery. Yeah, very good, but be humble. There's a hope, nah, but who knows? Huh? This is only a vision, we hope to get there. So, but how do we achieve this? The four, the mission, life ready, work ready, and world ready. Holistic, like you guys are doing holistic, right? In the college. So, yes. Very lucky to do this, you know. Very impressive what you guys are doing. This holistic. We hope to do that also to our students here, to all of them. Global, a lot of courses are global, inputs get there. We send them overseas as well. Creating, learning, and social, this is to encourage them to learn on their own, rather than relying on a lecturer to teach. So a lot of later you see in the world, our classrooms are like this, all over, no more that straight, rigid classroom, no more. We are trying to move away from that. And then here for the lecturers, make sure the lecturers came up to date. We don't want the lecturer to be yellow. We'll be up to date. Huh? The things are changing, the lecturer better change. So building capability, this is for the staff here. Because down there, things are changing very quickly. We were set up in 54. Even before Singapore founded. You know. Singapore, you know, right, founded when? 1960 or so. When?
1967.
Can we split from Malaysia a lot? You all should know, 65, the day when we were kicked out by your Prime Minister, Abdul Rahman, huh? The Tunku said goodbye. So we ran 65, huh? So these are, we were formed even before by the British. Full-time diploma students, 15,000, right? We have a lot of part-time, this is just a rough figure. CET stands for Continuing Education and Training, 36,000 a year. These are yearly figures. So a lot of students come in evening for upgrading. We have 48 full-time diploma 3-year long. And these are done part-time, advanced specialist in conversion diploma, can be 1 to 2 year long. This for upgrading. The diploma guy come here to upgrade, even university guys come here to upgrade. They also come here. Because they've done the same science, but we offer the specialization. So we have the equipment and the teaching stuff. 8 part-time, alumni so far 184,000 have graduated since 50-something. Start 1,007. Okay, 1,007 staff. That's the number of lecturers and admin staff like me. The school, there are 10 schools. We have clustered them this way into 4 or 5 clusters. Engineering cluster, electrical and electronics, school of mechanical and aeronautical. This is the Singapore Maritime Academy where we train the seafarers, our ship masters are trained here. People from all over the world also come here for training. Architecture, design, environment cluster, 2 schools, architecture, built environment, and the school of design. Is aircon working?
I don't think so.
Yeah, warm, huh? I'm sweating. I'm going to say. Design school. Then the communications cluster has 2 schools, Mental Science and the School of Communication Arts and Social Sciences. We have a drama, we have a diploma, applied drama for psychology. Very interesting diploma. The School of Business. I used to be from the School of Business, I was the director then. And doing something different now. We offer accountancy and so on. Digital is an IT school. And then we are here. At the School of Chemical Life Sciences, we're visiting this school. Very interesting school with very varied diplomas. From optometry, to food and nutrition and wellness, to biotechnology, and what else. There are 9 disciplines. Very disparate. It's a very interesting school. You all chosen the right school. Any questions? What schools are you all from?
I'm from Life Sciences, Applied Science, Chemistry.
Social science.
Oh. Any from business?
Yeah, we have several.
Psychology.
Any from design or something, IT?
Engineering?
I want the better students to get into a college. You want the elite, is it? Are you in the university? In the U-town here, only the better students get into the colleges.
Oh,
you
might
say that. Yeah, same thing, U-town also, only the better students get into the colleges. So this is the textbooks. How do we make sure we are work ready? Our graduates are many ways, many strategies. The curriculum itself is like that. Every student must do an internship offer, now lasting to 4 to 6 months long. Mm-hmm. Yourself, any internship?
Yes, 3 months.
Yeah.
2 months.
No, 3 months. 3 months.
Very good. The difficulties we have, of course, your university has also, I'm sure. Mm-hmm. Making sure the internship is relevant and valuable and not wasting your time. Mm-hmm. It is important. So we work very closely with many, many companies, 2,000 companies, just SP itself. We make sure that these companies look after the students and teach them, train them, not just make coffee and tea for the bosses and photocopy. You know, it has happened. Yeah. So we go and check our lecturer is assigned to every student. He goes and make sure that everything is done properly. There's a log book recorded, the work is recorded. Now, final year project, every student to do a project in the final year. I'm sure you too have to do. We're trying to make sure that there's some industry involvement in the project, meaning the project is useful to a company, hopefully, but not all of it. The difficult to achieve, we target 30 to 40%. Collaboration, we do R&D, although we are polytechnic, we do a lot of R&D. We have like 100 like staff just for R&D alone. Our R&D is more developing. Like example, they came up with a dengue, very quick way to test dengue. We did it in this center. This center we are here came up with that first in Singapore. We beat the universities. So we are good in the development part, not the art part, but making sure things go to the industry. We are very good at converting ideas into reality.
Yeah.
That's called the big D. We are not bad at that. So we have 100 staff working on that, full time. There are a lot of them PhDs, most of them are. Staff industry, our lecturers, we expect them to go back to the industry and come back. Update, come back, or do work very good. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, they become outdated very quickly. Every school has an advisory committee. At the university, typically, you guys don't have that. University don't have that. The polys, we have. The advisory committee consists of industry experts. They sit there, they check the curriculum. Whereas the School of Business, right, have accountants and all the sitting there. They'll tell me, migrant, maybe you have to look at this new thing. They include in the curriculum. And I say, okay, I get info.